the art of losing myself in bringing you praise everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame. In my heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out.
This is our prayer, O God, that you be in control of everything that we are, everything that we have. Your will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself
in bringing you praise
everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame.
Yeah.
My heart and my soul,
Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out.
Yes, Lord.
Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades,
never ending. The cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out to you.
Oh, we surrender our lives, Lord. Lord, we thank you for your presence. Church, let's sing, In My Heart.
My heart and my soul,
I give you control.
Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Everlasting,
your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all
fame. And the cry of my heart is to from the inside out, Lord, my soul.
Everlasting,
everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades, never ending.
Your glory goes beyond all fame.
And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the
from the inside out, Lord, my soul cries out to you. Holy, 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 Lord God
our song child.
holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy. All the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which word and art and evermore shall be.
Together, let's all sing the last verse. Lord God Almighty, we praise you.
Holy, holy, holy.
Scripture will be found in Haggai 2:10-23. On the 24th day of the ninth month, in the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Haggai. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Ask the priests what the law says. If someone carries consecrated meat in the fold of their garment, and that fold touches some bread or stew, some wine, olive oil, or other food, does it become consecrated? The priest answered, no. Then Haggai said, if a person defiled by contact with a dead body touches one of these things, does it become defiled? Yes, the priest replied, it becomes defiled. Then Haggai said, so it is with this people and this nation in my sight, declares the Lord. Whatever they do and whatever they offer there is defiled. Now give careful thought to this from this day on. Consider how things were before the stone was laid on another in the Lord's temple. When anyone came to a heap of 20 measures, there were only 10. When anyone went to a wine vat to draw 50 measures, there were only 20. I struck all the work of your hands with blight, mildew, and hail, yet you did not return to me, declares the Lord. From this day on, from this 24th day of the ninth month, give careful thought to the day when the foundation of the Lord's temple was laid. Give careful thought, is there yet any seed left in the barn? Until now, the vine and the fig tree, the pomegranate and the olive tree have not borne fruit. From this day on, I will bless you. The word of the Lord came to Haggai a second time on the 24th day of the month. Tell Zerubbabel, governor of Judah, that I am going to shake the heavens and the earth. I will overturn royal thrones and shatter the power of the foreign kingdoms. I will overthrow chariots and their drivers. Horses and their riders will fall, each by the sword of his brother. On that day, declares the Lord Almighty, I will take you, my servant Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, declares the Lord, and I will make you like my signet ring, for I have chosen you, declares the Lord Almighty. This is the reading of God's word. You may be seated.
We are wrapping up our study of the book of Haggai. And Haggai is just two chapters, but it's taken us 3 weeks. And forgive me for getting confused. It's not three chapters, it's only two. Somebody pointed that out, that I made that mistake. But nevertheless, it is good that we get to study something that sounds really obscure, isn't it? Something that is hard to understand, but nevertheless part of the Bible. And we know that being part of the Bible, it's important to study it. In fact, it's so important that in our college days, Sally and I both heard this message from Haggai, and it made an impact on our lives, especially when it kept saying, consider your ways. Now give thought to what you're doing. And it said over and over again, consider your ways. When you're a college student in the Philippines and you're thinking about your ways, and it becomes sort of like a question of where are you going with your life? What are you doing with it? Okay, so that's the big question we have for today, because remember the past two Sundays we have been studying things about priorities, right? And we said, you know, the illustration of the fingers, what does this stand for? God. And this one? And this one? Children. And this one? Church. And this one? Friends. Okay, everybody else. Now, these are the priorities, but mainly about prioritizing God. And I know that you all have different priorities living here in New York. And perhaps, in some ways, work becomes a priority, so it's upside down, because work, studies, you know, what else? Going out, perhaps, to have fun, because it's a very stressful week. Going out on holidays, perhaps, because you need a break. And there's nothing wrong with that, of course. Now, these are important. All of them are important, but don't get your priorities wrong, right? Why? Because we know that putting God first fixes everything, right? Putting God first puts everything in their place. Recently, we heard a testimony that powerfully illustrates this. That God has been withholding something from her. She's been praying for a long time for the opportunity to be able to practice her profession. And God has not given it to her. And because of that, she felt like things were really bad for her family. But you know what? God had His perfect time. God made sure that she prioritizes God first, along, of course, with her husband, so that they knew that putting God first in their life would fix everything else. Right? So her marriage was fixed. Her child was put in the right place in terms of his needs, and everything else in their life fitted their plans. So in God's way, in God's time. But you know, the topic this morning has to do with the right priorities brings true success, and the success we're looking for is not in the ways of the world, because success in this world simply means that you've made it, you've fulfilled your destiny, so to speak, and you have become somebody you were meant to be. No? Self-fulfillment. But that is not God's concept of success. So this morning, I want you to realize that there is an opportunity and a privilege that you are being given, and that this opportunity and privilege is the greatest privilege of all. And so we will tackle this little by little as we look into what this book is about. Going back to the book of Haggai now, what is this? You see many of these in Israel and in many parts of the world that are old, right? They're ruins. No? They're remnants of what used to be a big structure or a place that is magnificent, okay? Admirable, amazing. And we say, and even in Thailand, you see a lot of these remnants, right? Of temples, great temples. What happened? Let's just have a short review. When the Southern Kingdom, those of you who weren't here when you heard this, fell to Babylon, in 586 BC, that's this part, Solomon's temple was destroyed. So it was in ruin. But a king came along, a king who replaced this Babylonian king, Nebuchadnezzar, whose name is Cyrus of the Medo-Persian Empire. So this is a bit of history. The Bible is full of history. Why is it full of history? Because the Bible is true. It's verifiable facts. You don't only find this account in the Bible, you find it in the many writings of the ancient Near East. What is that decree? In fact, you can see this remnant in the museums. This Cyrus has written it in his language, of course, in a cylinder. And we have a replica that I saw in our seminary. He said, it's time for the Jews to return to Jerusalem. And you know, using somebody like that to promulgate a prophecy that the Jews will return to Israel after, or to Jerusalem after exile, is something really amazing. So what happened? In 536 BC, they started to rebuild the temple. And in 530 BC, they stopped rebuilding. Why did they stop? Pastor TJ told us last week that they were discouraged because there were opponents, right? There was opposition to their building. Not only that, they were discouraged because they were told, this doesn't look anywhere like what we had before, this temple that we're building, so it's not that great. But they completed it in 515 BC. So it actually was completed. That's the history. In fact, it's foretold in Ezra, that the first year of King Cyrus, the king issued a decree. And that decree was something that is amazing because these are people in exile. Do they have money? No. So how are they going to rebuild the temple? Notice here it says, and let the cost be paid from the royal treasury. So the rebuilding of the temple was at the expense of King Cyrus. Just like the story we had this morning, you said that one of your students got a scholarship from the Thai government. How amazing is that? So will God provide? Of course. When you put God first, when you prioritize His priorities, His purposes, then you are provided for. And we have that similar testimony in our church, isn't it? We've heard of scholarships being given to some of our young people, part-time maybe, but still a bit of scholarship here and there, right? And for that, we should be thankful. So we should be thankful, but also we should realize that God's purposes are being met. I wondered about this. What's this royal treasury? There's no Jewish treasury, so to speak. They have no money. But there was the Persian royal treasury. But wait, there's more. In the advertisement. Moreover, issue a decree concerning what you are to do for the elders of Judah and the rebuilding of this house of God. The full cost is to be paid to these people from the royal treasury out of the taxes of the provinces beyond the river, and that without delay. So it wasn't like, the government issuing a law and then nothing happens. This was a king who was saying, this will happen. He's not a God worshiper, this Cyrus. And oftentimes, we tend to think that way, that God will use somebody to bring about His purposes. True. But many times, it's not that case. It's us whom God will use. And we will examine that this morning. We will see how, in the book of Haggai, let's go back to Haggai. Now therefore, thus says the Lord, consider your ways. Notice how many times in verse 1, verse 7, verse 15, and verse 18. Do consider. Think about it. In the same way that we should think about what we're doing. Because the greatest privilege, the greatest blessing that this world can never offer, and that you and I could never manufacture or create, we could never buy or steal or borrow, but God is saying, I want you to experience it. Have you ever sat down and taken a deep breath and looked at what you're doing in your life? Who occupies the thumb of your hand? Is it God? When we put God first, everything else falls into place. And you know that part of His plan is to make us His temple. We see this not just in the book of Haggai, but in 1 Corinthians. It says that, do you not know that you are a temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? Holy, 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 you sing this morning. How often do you sing that song? Only when you come to church? Because you feel like it's a holy place? No. This song should be sung everywhere you are. Even in the midst of a noisy, dirty, crowded subway train. Even in the midst of a stressful, just hard schoolwork. In the middle of the night and you're trying to finish whatever assignment you have. The Spirit of God dwells in you. And therefore, you are in a holy place. What does that mean? What does it mean to have the Spirit of God dwelling in you? You see, many, many times we pray that God's presence will be here. That's not a bad prayer. But let me ask you, is God's presence already here because of you? When you're not here, and this is just a building, do you think God is present in this place? For sure. Yes? But God chooses to dwell in His people. So when you invite God to come and dwell or be present in your midst, you're actually saying, because we are gathered together as a church, then He is our temple. I've said this over and over again. The idea of temple in the Bible is not referring to a physical building. Neither Solomon's temple or this building that we have here. Good, yes, we have those places where we can gather because it's hard to find a place where we can have 100 plus people every Sunday. No? In fact, in just a bit of an aside, we were being asked by movie producers to have downstairs our basement as a gathering place for their crew. And you know how many movies are made in New York City. I won't go into that. But the point is this. This is an opportunity, a building, yes, but let's not forget, it's the people who make the temple, not the building. Now, what does that mean for you and me? When we say that the Spirit of God dwells in you and me, then the holiness that is God becomes yours, becomes part of who we are together. But you say, I don't want to say Pastor Dodi. In America, it's Dodi. You don't know what I'm like. When I come in here, I want to be cleaned. I want to be purified. I want to ask God to make His presence known to me. But you and I will never be as clean as we want to be. Perfection is not the aim. The aim is to say that God's holiness is manifested in us through our changed lives. That we are being transformed, that we are being changed. Not from something that is very bad, perhaps, to something that is very good, perhaps, but slowly and progressively. Why? Because there are two things I want you to realize. Ages ago, people would look at the temple and say, God is there. That's where His glory dwells. Today, God wants people to look at you and me and say, God is there. That's where His glory dwells. Not because we are perfect, but because we are people who have or show something different because God is making that difference in us. So later on in your discipleship groups, you have what is called MAD in your discussions. MAD stands for making a difference. And in fact, as a believer, you will be discussing this because where is your life today? What is your passion? What are you doing that the Spirit of God is dwelling in you? Let me go through this several doctrinal statements. You see, there are two aspects of holiness One is called positional holiness, and the other is called progressive holiness. Now, these are concepts that are a bit abstract, especially for the young people. Let me ask you, are you students? Positionally, you are, right? Positionally means you're in that place, you're in that position where you are currently a student, correct? Or nurses? Are you nurses, positionally? Yes, because you have been given that vocation, or teachers, or engineers, or whatever vocation you have been called to, even pastors. Remember, God chose us in Him before the foundation of the world. He chose us. He made us positionally holy. What does holy mean? Set apart. Set apart. Don't forget that word. Holy doesn't mean I have a halo on top of my head, although I do sometimes when the light shines in my head. No, it's actually not that concept of walking around and sort of like hands folded down and never smiling. Oh, that person is really holy. Especially in Thailand, no, many monks who walk the streets, you can recognize them as holy men. But holy for what? Holy set apart for God is what we're after, because He said, "We chose us." He chose us. Why? So that in Him, in Christ, we would be holy and blameless before Him. Very important concept. He didn't choose us to be holy so that we can be praised by other people. Because, you know, in many societies, He's a holy man. And they look up to that holy man. We are not made holy so that we can say and brag about how good we are. But we are made holy to say and brag about how good God is. And people accuse us many times of that. Because they say, oh, you're trying to be holier than me. As if holiness is something that we attain, that we have achieved. No, it's something that God gave us. Do you follow? It's something that God has put in us, a position of being blameless and holy in Him, in Christ. Don't ever forget that. In Him means you are united to Christ. We were baptized into Him so that we were buried in terms of our death, of our sin, dead to our sin. It says that in the next verse. God being rich in mercy because of His great love in which He loved us, even when we were dead. No? In our transgressions, He made us alive. Together with Christ, in unity with Christ, by grace, you have been saved. That's very important to realize, from positional holiness. But then we have another aspect of it. Because if God has given us this holiness wherein He has raised us with Him and seated us with Him in the heavenly places, it's like Jesus telling you, come sit with me. What, me? Sit with Jesus? That's what He's saying here. We have been raised with Him so that we may be seated with Him in the heavenly places. That's our position. But let me ask you, if you were suddenly become made a royalty, if you were suddenly invited to Windsor Palace or one of these places, do you automatically become royalty? No. You're just a commoner who is now in this royal household. Just like a car doesn't become, somebody doesn't become a car because he's in the carport, right? And we've heard this illustration before. But the point is this, positional holiness is something we don't achieve, it's been received. But the other kind of holiness, progressive holiness, is something that's being worked out in us. And we call this another doctrinal term, sanctification. When you became a Christian, you weren't automatically made into someone you are not. You still remain who you are, right? You cannot change the identity of where you grew up, how you grew up, and what status you have in life, correct? But God has changed you from the inside. He has given you His Spirit. Now you become a temple of the Holy Spirit. Now you become a child of His. Now you are royalty. Why? Because you are a child of the King. When I first realized this, I was in the rice terraces of, of you know, the rice dresses in Baguio, or not Baguio, but Benguet, no? So I was in the rice terraces, and I was listening to this person who was saying, you know, in this tribe, they have royalty. And if you want a ring that shows that you're part of the royalty, you can buy it for 10 pesos down the road. And I go, wow, that will make me feel like royalty. So I did. I mean, I was very naive. So I took the 10 pesos and I put it on. And after putting it on, I said, hey, I don't feel like royalty. No? I don't really feel like royalty. Why? Because royalty has to be progressively learned. So you see this Prince Harry and Prince, what's the other one? William. I was just reading something on Facebook the other day, and they said, you can tell their royalty. You can tell that they were raised by a princess, wasn't it? And who was that princess who raised her? Diana. So they have the quality of royalty. I don't know what that means, but I guess it means that the eyes of the world, they are someone you can look up to. In our case, progressive holiness says, so then, my beloved, just as you always have obeyed, not only in my presence, that's Paul speaking, but now much more in my absence, what does he say? Work out your salvation. No? Practice your being royalty. You've been saved. You've been placed in the heavenly, seated at the right hand of Christ. How do you practice this royalty? You work it out, not you work for. You don't work for being holy. You work out what's already in you, the presence of the Holy Spirit, so that His presence shines through. It is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for His good pleasure. We come to this very odd part in Haggai. It's odd because it's talking about something that is probably not familiar to you. What's this talk about contamination or defilement? Because this is something that came to Haggai, and it tells you what specific date that was. This was 2 months after they started building the temple. And he's saying, ask the priests for a ruling. What's the question? The question is this. If a man is carrying holy meat, okay, so let's say I walk into this place and I'm carrying the communion plates. And the communion plates, let me tell you, these are holy. Not because they are something, there's some magic in them, or there's something that if I drop the the cover, which I often do, Pastor Dodi dropped the holy things, no? That is something that is unforgivable. I can be stricken dead. No. These are holy because they have been set apart. Remember that word? They have been set apart for God's use. And so if we run out of cups, especially as it happens when there are many more people than we expected, you don't say, we did something wrong. As Josiah would say, Mama, boo-boo, no? And when he was a baby, no? Bobo, see? You go on and on. So I think many times we think that way. But God is saying, if a man carries meat in the fold of his garment, so he carries meat. Those days they carry meat to burn as an offering, right? We don't do that, by the way. So don't ever think we have to do that. Because now that has been replaced with the new covenant. This new covenant is in the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Does it mean that if somebody takes this bread and drinks this cup, he becomes holy because that has touched his lips and his body? And what did the priest say? No. Holiness is not contagious. It's not something you pass on from you as a parent to your child. Holiness is something that is inherently God's choice in terms of your positional holiness. Okay? Now, what's the other question? The other question is this, and it's the reverse. In the Jewish law, in the Torah, and please bear with me, I'll explain just a few more things about their law. If somebody touches a corpse, a dead body, then you are unclean. You are defiled. No? And anything that you touch becomes defiled and unclean. And of course, there's a whole ritual about how to get yourself clean and purified again. And the question is, if a man who touches a corpse, at any of these, will the latter become unclean? So if a man who touches a corpse touches his wife, does his wife become unclean too? And the answer is yes. It will become unclean. That's the last part of it. So what does that mean? It means simply this. Holiness is not contagious, but sin is. Remember that. Holiness is not contagious, but sin is. Do you believe that? Have you experienced it? If you haven't, then you're not experiencing this progressive holiness that God is talking about. You see, the problem is, we bring our offerings, we bring, as it were, our incense, but to the Lord, they are an abomination. Our assemblies become just a place where sin defiles what we do. And some of you are feeling that. You're feeling that within your families, perhaps, or within your household, there is sin that needs to be dealt with, but it continues on and on and on, and so you feel weighed down. You can't do anything about it. You suffer physically as well because of all that sin entails. You become sick, and you have people dying because of sin. And you have others being affected by that sin. This is what Isaiah is saying. Come now and let us reason together. Though your sins are as scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they will be like gold. So God is able to deal with your sin and mine. God is able to deal with our sin when we repent and believe in the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Believe in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. But you say, Pastor Dodi, or Dodi, I already believe. What do you mean believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ? Because the gospel of Jesus Christ not only gives you positional holiness, makes you part of God's family, makes you part of His kingdom, so to speak, so that you are inheritors, but also makes you experience the greatest experience there is in growing in holiness in terms of progressive holiness. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ continually saves you and me since the day we accepted Him into our life. Because many times, and here's the problem, I think most of us think that we are saved once for all. You agree? Once saved, always saved. The great Baptist confession. But we are forgetting that once saved, although we are always saved, we are still being saved. Saved from ourselves even. Because our lives before we met Christ has not been acceptable to God. We are sinners by nature, born sinners. And we have been used to doing things in our old ways. Why do I say that? Well, simply because in terms of our habits, okay, let's think about it. Where do you spend most of your time? Or where do you spend most of your money? Or where do you spend most of your energies? Well, of course, the very first thing your answer would be work, isn't it? Work. So work is a priority, right? Perhaps not God. Remember that? God is priority, not work, not the other way around. Why? Because if we decide to keep working and working and working even on, say, other days when we don't have to work, then we are proving that our priority is not God, isn't it? And our progressive holiness is therefore stunted, and we don't grow. And sometimes it's not entirely our fault. Sometimes we are victims of what we might say, circumstances. Oh, I invested in this, and therefore I have to work more to pay for this investment. Oh, my children are studying in the best school in America, Harvard University, Yale, or whatever, and therefore I have to work more so I can put my child through that education. But what's become of your priorities? Because your priority has been goals that you've set for yourself, contrary to what God has set for you. You forget God is a priority, you become more and more entrapped. You become trapped. See, we repent, we believe, because we want to be fruitful. We want to give generously. And I'm not just saying generously in terms of giving to the church. I'm saying that you're so generous because you know that God is a generous God and you can give to your heart's content and not withhold things for those things you know are needed by people, Pastor Sunny included in his ministry in Thailand. But if you have your priorities right, that God is your priority, then that relative who needs your help because he's desperately ill, back in the Philippines where the cost of medical care is so large, then you become sort of like discouraged that you cannot help because of all the obligations you have. And we came across this in one of our counseling where the generosity of someone is being stifled, being held back because simply they're not saving wisely. What's that? Save? We don't save anymore, do we? Because we think that tomorrow will come and God will take care of us. Yes, for sure. But God is already taking care of you now with what you have, with your income. So save. Be wise. Just like what the book of Proverbs says, look to the ant. Because it saves for winter, doesn't it? Also, so you can live appropriately. If you're not living appropriately, you're spending your whole life trying to amass things which later on you find to be useless anyway. Now, it satisfies the first 2 weeks, like the experience I had when Apple Watch. You know, I said, oh, this is really good. It's going to change my life and my fitness. After 2 weeks, I started discovering some of the things that it promised but never delivered. I sent it back. Good thing Costco takes back things, right? For decisions that you haven't made. Right. Of course, they've had the problem that I told them about. The thing that bothers me is that we are so concentrated on living a life that is for ourselves. So that we don't anymore think of others the way that God wants us to think of others. So that if we are generous in giving, it's because God is generous to us. So that if we are able to save, it's because God is generous to us. And we are also living appropriately because we know that God wants us to live appropriately so we can save and we can give generously. That is how the people of God were being told back in those days in the temple. You live in your paneled houses. You live in well-appointed homes. 5-star. But the temple is in ruins. I'd like to end with a few thoughts. Perhaps Haggai, and I will just skip some of it because it's talking about how, consider again, before you started building this temple and you came to look for grain, you expected to have 20 and you only had 10. You went to the wine vat to draw 50 measures and you only had 20. What is that saying? It's coming short. No? You're earning this much. But, sabi nga, ni Pastor TJ, butas ang bulsa. Right? Remember last week? Huh? Ang kawawang cowboy. No? And the thing is, we actually see this as an evidence of God's work. Did you know that? God is actually doing that. He said, I smote you. And every work of your hands, with blasting, with mildew, and hail. Yet you did not come back to me. Notice the next verse. Is there seed still in your barn? The vine, the fig tree, the pomegranate, and the olive tree, no fruit. Notice that next line. Yet, from this day, I will bless you. How is that? You know, God smote me, did not make me fruitful. I'm in trouble with my debts. My credit card is maxed and I'm having so much interest on my credit card. And yet God says, I will bless you. What is the basis for that prayer? Let me end with this. By the way, we're using CCF stuff, right? But I'm not entirely depending on it. We are actually very similar to that because we are trying to make Christ committed followers who will in turn make Christ committed followers. Notice the pun on the words or the abbreviation, Christ Committed Followers, CCF, right? We're using this, so I kept it because I didn't want to say I made this up. But the first thing they have in their mission statement is to honor God. Are we honoring God in the way we're living our lives? Consider your ways. Are you honoring God? You see, the last part of this is about Zerubbabel, which probably you don't understand. This promise to Zerubbabel, the governor, saying, I'm going to shake the heavens and the earth. Pastor TJ mentioned this. Shake as in the judgment of God is going to come. Judgment day, on the last day when Jesus returns. And it says, I will overthrow kingdoms and destroy the power of the kingdoms of the nations. I will overthrow the chariots and their riders, and the horses and the riders will go down. Everyone will fall by their sword. Where do you see this? In the book of Revelation. No? You will see this in the book of Revelation. When Christ comes back, He will overthrow everyone who has tried to gain power instead of His. Why? Because Zerubbabel, the father of whose father was Shealtiel, etc. But Jacob was the father of Joseph, husband of Mary, by whom Jesus was born, called the Messiah. Zerubbabel comes from the lineage of Jesus. And the promise is not to Zerubbabel per se. The promise is about his son. Because I will make you a signet ring. I have chosen you. What's a signet ring? A ring of authority. A ring of power. So this verse is saying, Jesus is coming. In the Old Testament, it's always about Jesus. Zerubbabel is just a type. It's a foreshadowing. It's something like a prediction of what's going to be. So if somebody here comes and he represents a high official, that person is going to come to see what's going to happen here when that high official comes, right? To check out the place. And so when the real person comes, then you know that he's the real deal. Zerubbabel is that. He's being groomed, so to speak, to be a representation of who Christ is. Why? Because we are in ruins. Our life is broken. And we need God's transformation to change us from the inside out. I ask you this morning, as I have already asked you many times, God saved you. And when you keep it to yourself and not help those who are lost, those who are without hope, hopeless, the distressed, and you don't help them to discover who Jesus is as their Messiah, they will not live as God's holy temple. They will not be part of God's kingdom. And that includes perhaps your children, perhaps your spouse, perhaps your close friends. And you don't want that. Because it's never about just us. It's about people that God is calling to Himself. I say this because evangelism has become a word that means programs. Okay, let's go track distribution. Okay, let's go out to a park and have a prayer booth. Nothing wrong with that. But your lifestyle, as you will discuss today, is it a testimony of God's positional holiness that He's made you into, and your progressive holiness as He's changing you? Think about these things. Consider your ways. So that people who see you, your family, will say, God is there. It's where His glory dwells. So that when God sees this church up into the future, will He find us faithful and say to us, God is there. That's where His glory dwells. Not because we are perfect, but because people see the difference God is making in our lives. Are we a church that's perfect? Far be it. What do they say? If you find a perfect church, don't join it, you'll make it imperfect. Right? God wants your life not to make it perfect, not so you can follow a list of rules, not that you will have no problems, not that everything will be rosy and without any issues, but He's chosen you so that you will be His dwelling place, His holy temple, so that people will see, not you, but God's presence in you and in us. And today we celebrate the Lord's Supper again. Because this is the symbol. This is the evidence that you have pledged allegiance to our God. Because on the night when our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, He took bread and said, let me break it for you. Just like the Lord Jesus Christ broke bread. And He said, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat of it in remembrance of me.